is Medina Crespo, son of Genaro Medina and Matea Crespo. Medina, a last name with a very interesting history, and to the younger generation here, pay attention, because these are your roots. The use of the term Medina dates back to the Muslim rule in Spain from the year 711 to 1492. It originates from the Arabic word Medina. Medina means city and is a Quranic name for girls. But there is a very particular Medina, and it means the city of the Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah upon him, which is known as Al-Madinah, and it is in Saudi Arabia, a major Islamic pilgrimage site. Medina in Arabic has the same linguistic derivation with the Aramaic Hebrew word referring to a city or populated area. How about that? Medina in the Bible. The surname Medina was derived from several cities and towns of Spain, such as Medina del Campo, Medina de Pomar, and many others. Various Christian families from these localities took Medina as a surname during the Reconquista in 1492, when Christians, under the orders of King Fernando and Queen Isabel, reconquered Spain and expelled the Muslim or Moors that had occupied it for more than 780 years. 1942 was also the year when Christopher Columbus discovered America and Puerto Rico a year later. The surname Medina was then imported to the Spanish colonies by the conquistadores. Medina is a common surname among Sephardic Jews, which are Jewish people that come from Spain and were also expelled with the Moors. Now, in Puerto Rico, many years later, Juan Genaro Medina, married to Matea Crespo, fathered a baby boy named Luis Medina, in the remote mountain village of Ay Bonito, in the Medina of Arecibo, on April 28, 1930 at 4 p.m. And the Medinas continue. Birth and family. Don Genaro Medina dies when Luis was only 6 years old, leaving Doña Matea with six children: Santa, Consuelo, Lily, Manuel, Luis, and Maria. She finds herself in a helpless position and allows good families in her mountain village to help her raise four of her six children. In 1936, Luis becomes part of the family of Don Eligio Rosado and Doña Paz Arce, who at the time have only one baby boy, Benjamin. There he saw the birth of Aida, Irma, Lucy, and Wilfredo, which he helps in their rearing, and who became his for life brothers and sisters, and for life mama and papa. Spiritual upbringing. Luis attended the Seventh-day Adventist church that his new family, the Rosados, had built on their property. The Rosados were one of the pioneering families of the Adventist message in the north area of Puerto Rico during the early 1920s. Luis kept his faith in God throughout his life. His teen years. As a teen, he worked hard at the farm and studied as he could at the local neighborhood school. During his late teens, he went to work at the capital of the island, San Juan, 2 hours away, and settled sometime later in the area of Vega Alta, where he lost contact with the Rosado family for a short while. his 20s. After the World War II in 1945, many Puerto Ricans began to immigrate to the United States for jobs and better economic situation. In 1953, and being only 23 years old, Luis decides to immigrate to Chicago with a group of young men from his childhood neighborhood, also in search of a better life. As a man concerned with his future, he finds work at a menswear factory and works hard, ironing suits, and later becomes the clothing inspector. It is in the Medina of Chicago that the happy, funny, hard-working Luis meets a fellow Caribbean, beautiful young Cuban named Esther Soler, daughter of Jose Soler and Carmita Rodriguez. With their blessing, Luis marries Esther in 1956. A year after, his first son, Jose Luis, Joey, is born, and 2 years later, in 1959, his second son, Haroldo, known as Bibi, arrives. By this time, Luis has become part of Esther Soler's clan, who are happily led by the strong spiritual matriarch, Carmita Rodriguez, who, like Abraham, takes the family composed of son and daughters with their spouses and children around the United States in search of their Canaan, the land of milk and honey, the land where they can be blessed and bless others as well. His 30s. In 1962, the Medinas, together with the Soler clan, find themselves in Miami, Florida, where Luis works at Hialeah Hospital as director of housekeeping. Their stay in Miami is short, and in 1963, both clans move up to Madison, Tennessee, where they continue working in the hospital system and close to where there is an SDA hub. Little Wilfred is born in 1965. The last of the Medina boys. Another year passes. It is 1966, and their attention moves this time to the area of Orlando, Florida, where, again, both clans end up and finally cross the Jordan River and grow roots in the midst of the Florida hospital system and the many SDA churches around. They have arrived. But sadly, like Moses, Mother Carmita is not able to enjoy the land that she dreamed of and passes to sleep in the Lord. Luis and Esther are in the midst of raising children and find their new home near Bear Lake on Marie Avenue. Their home is close to the SDA educational system where Joey, Bibi, and Wilfred will get their education for their next 12 years, starting at Fleece and ending at Forest Lake Academy. Parents, doing the best they can to form the future of their children. And while all this is taking place, Luis is working for Food for Life as a baker. He enjoys his job and does it well. His 40s. It is 1971, and Disney World has just opened. Life is being injected to the area of Orlando, and new subdivisions are popping up everywhere. Not steering too far, Luis and Esther find a new house at 128 Alhambra Avenue, Forest City. A small SDA Spanish group meets at Forest Lake Church, and Luis and Esther makes it their own. It soon develops into what we know now as Forest City Spanish SDA Church. Luis happily participates in the choir and as a deacon. An important part of the church are the social nights where Luis and many others gather and domino is shuffled around on tables as many aficionados happily fellowship. And the boys keep on growing. Around 1976, Luis receives a call from the SDA Antillean College in Mayagüez, Puerto Rico, to develop a student bakery, to lead it, and to, of course, be the chief baker. He seized the opportunity, hoping to introduce his children to the place that is dear to his roots. Once again, they move close to an SDA hospital, Bella Vista, and to the SDA college, the Antillean. Plans eventually change, and in 1979, the family returns back to Florida, where their Alhambra house awaits, and Luis takes up a different career path this time, by working at Florida Hospital Maintenance Department as a painter, which he also enjoys. Eventually, his sons follow his same footsteps, but independently. His 50s. Luis and Esther stay put during the 1980s. Their sons start to leave the nest, to find their own path, just as Luis had done in his own time, on his own terms. And the term of buitres, vultures, is born, which is used as an endearing way of referring to the youth of the day, including his sons and nephews. We who knew him understood him and laughed. His 60s. 1990s. Luis leaves the area of Forest City and builds, with the help of his son Haroldo, a new house in Orange City. By this time, they also have changed churches and are worshiping at the Deltona SDA Church, where their membership remains. 1992. Now, with an empty nest and with all the buitres out with their own little nest, 62-year-old Luis retires, and his compass points again to Puerto Rico, this time to his little inheritance at the mountain village of his childhood. There, he built his own house up on a hill and around the rocks and through the woods. It is farming time. It is reminiscent time. All is good, all is well, until in 1999, they feel an inner pull. Something is happening in faraway Deltona. Something does not leave them alone, and they can't resist any longer, and they return. They return to their grandchildren, who manage to pull their heartstrings from afar. Now, as abuelo and abuela, they have come to care, to love, and to enjoy a bunch of little Medinas, the next generation of little buitres. Kyle, 1985. Ashley, 1986. Ariana, 1990. Austin, 1997. Twins, Alicia and Alexis, 2000. Samantha, 2003. Even little Camden, 2013, his only great-grandson. His 70s. A new millennium has started. The year is 2000. Life has been changing rapidly. Technology is out of control. But in the life of Luis, there is peace. He is enjoying what he can. He's enjoying the labor of his brow, his wife, his sons, his grandchildren, his extended family, even his malanga con bacalao. Although he likes to travel, he also loves to get back home. You will hear the inevitable whisper, "Psst, let's go." His 80s. Luis has become an octogenarian. Life is running slower. Little things here and there are creeping into his health. It has become harder to take care of the once strong, active, and happy man that Luis was. No, his quirkiness hasn't left him. In the middle of his now becoming health issues, he still can pull a rabbit out of the hat and make you laugh. In 2017, and with mixed feelings from Esther and the boys, Luis becomes a resident of the Villas of the Land. His alertness and his mind start to slip from under his control. Sadly, we see him slowly depart from reality, at the same time that Esther, his dear and darling wife of 63 years, is going through difficult health issues herself that prevent her from helping him. He misses Esther. He misses home. Take me home. In his mind, the past is his present. He often asks his sister, "Is Mama okay? Does she know that I'm here? Why didn't you bring her?" Asking for Mama at the old age of 89. Mothers, fathers, how much we need them and miss them. 10:24, Sabbath morning, September 7, 2019. One day after Esther's birthday. One day after her darling husband rests.